Leslie, thank you so much for inviting me here, and thank you for that lovely introduction. So there's a couple of things I wanted to talk about today, and essentially, since I'm a visual artist, I'm going to show you images of some of my work created over the last couple of years, and take you through three major bodies of work done in the past 7 to 8 years. And during the process of that, I will talk about some key points, which I think at this point are very essential. Material and discursive possibilities in contemporary art framing of art and science. Here we will talk about a little bit about the possibilities of art-science collaborations and what it can do for the public. The urgency of the contemporary moment. Now, most of us are aware of the term Anthropocene. Do we know, does everybody here know about this term? So the word Anthropocene comes from anthropo, which means man, and scene, which comes from new. So it basically reflects the Earth's most recent geologic time frame or era, where man's all-consuming nature is completely altering Earth's systems and processes. So we'll talk about living in an era of the Anthropocene, choosing focus areas and alternate ways of seeing art in translation, some of the ways by which I process and translate research into practice, human and non-human narratives in the Anthropocene, basically talking about how, as humans, can we connect with our other than human kin. In an increasingly disturbed world today, is there still space for wonder? Here, in this section, I would like to talk about common ecologies, symbioses, and our very entangled ecologies of human and other life, like, you know, animals and plant life. And finally, address how will art and science come together in ways that can benefit all players and the public. Okay, so moving straight up, let's look at some images of the first body of work. This started in around 2012-2013, and this was a very initial phase of my engagement with art and science. So how I really started this body of work was to, travel the length and breadth of our country, documenting largely, mostly mangrove ecosystems. And here I started gradually looking at mangrove biodiversity. Slowly we will also talk about why is mangrove the focus of the subject. Now, quickly running through and telling you a little bit about this body of work. The Scapelin series embraces the macro ecologies of rivers, mangrove zones, and rock formations, and forest systems, studying them both scientifically and morphologically, of course, while translating them into the microcosm of the image. Scapelin combines the phases of expedition, research, documentation, and meditation, renewing landscape as a genre. Now, when we think of the word landscape, what do we really think of? Usually, what comes to mind is an artistic imagination, proposal of a particular way of seeing or representative or symbolizing the natural world, of transforming nature into a subject. Now, if we reverse this and we look at the title of the body of work, Scapelins, it is mirror twin. Scapelins then turns this very relationship between the subject and the artifice around making the scape the focus of the inquiry. So thus, at this point, we are engaging with the internalized aesthetic concepts and these art historical categories that form an integral part of our life world. Thus, the images gathered together to form scapelins act both as entries in a journal shaped within time, and as a cycle of archetypes standing outside the flux of time itself. Through a series of print and video works, the body of work eludes then a tourist simple categorization. Instead, I would say that they record a pilgrim's encounter with a universe that retains a measure of unfathomable otherness. that's another work from this series. These are images of how this work has been made. This is technically how the work was made. So these are all images of etchings. The base for this were photographic images from all of my shoots, and then they were transferred into the print media through the etching process. Moving inwards is a video. These are stills from the video. At the end of my presentation, I'll show you excerpts from some of the videos as well. So this is a work that was shot in Pichavaram in the coastal bio shields. Now, these dense forests are situated near the legendary and celebrated Chidambaram temple. If any of you have visited this area, you would be quite familiar with this. And this temple is dedicated to the worship of Lord Shiva. Now, associated with the temple, then Pichavaram incarnates the water cosmology at its most potent. Water is a shrine, and anyone who enters the mangrove forest therefore enters a sacred precinct or sanctuary. Now, coming to talk about mangroves. Mangroves are the membrane between the land and sea. While this work draws our attention to their majestic splendor, it also reminds us constantly of their crucial role in mitigating the devastating impact of the tsunamis. I try to make an experiential journey, tapping into a stratum of belief, cultural experience, and artistic representation as I navigate the watery labyrinths and narrow creeks and canals of these mangrove forests. The work then becomes, when you read into the work and when you see the video, the work becomes an exploration then into really gradually looking at the vectors of the human mind, the role of nature, the fragility of life, the preservation and conservation of life, and the role of humankind as makers. These are just images of some of the work installed at different venues here and outside India. The next series of work is called Critical Membrane. It marks my close engagement with both the present and the future of India's endangered coastal and mangrove systems, spanning prints, photographs, videos, and installation. This body of work addresses itself to the mangrove ecologies of India's Coromandel and Malabar coasts. My exploration of these regions has been inspired by an awareness of ecological catastrophe in these areas. The mangroves are an osmotic border between land and sea, and they are actually under grave threat from direct human interference, as well as the cataclysmic shifts in a natural world which is disordered by the long-term effects of technological activity. In my images of dying mangroves here and shrinking wetlands, we find the chronicles of many deaths foretold. So what happens here? This is an installation view from the 2016 Biennale in China. This is at the Yinchuan Museum of Contemporary Art. So the viewer essentially walks into this immersive space, and you find yourself surrounded by these images of dead and dying trees, mostly mangroves here, as well as images of salinated land and areas ridden with drought. Critical Membrane reminds us of the epochal cost that humankind must pay for its economic expansionism. Now, at this point, and with this work, I would really like to quote a philosopher who I greatly respect, and I had the wonderful opportunity of meeting him last month in Mumbai. His name is Akhil Bilgrami, and he has memorably phrased it by saying that this paradigm has replaced nature with natural resources, communities with populations, and the knowledge to live by and expertise to rule by. This instrumentalization of a life fold follows from the instrumentalization era mode of pitching humankind against nature. By contrast, research across a range of disciplines has encouraged us with increasing urgency in the recent decades to embrace and to understand that we inhabit a complex web of stimulus and response. And we also inhabit a space which is meant for intervention and also has severe repercussions. We are bound together by interrelationships that require a sensitive calibration, but we are treated, and these spaces are treated all too often with shockingly callous and ultimately self-destructive disregard. This body of work brings together a variety of impulses ranging from microscopic details of bacterial and microbial cultures, to then go on to looking at documentary cinematic studies of marginalized groups whose eco-sensitive occupations have started to suffer as a result of decline in their environment. But more than that, this work also reminds us and draws attention to the equally vital collaborative and empathetic aspects of my work. The thread through these labyrinths is woven through with the threads of other questers, other survivors, and other celebrants of resistance. This next set of work looks at the microbial communities which are found within ecosystems. The series of work was produced in collaboration with the M.S. Swaminathan Research Foundation, and I worked with some of their scientists there. The series has also been a result of a sustained collaboration with MSSRF, for which I'm very, very grateful. The microbial community of the mangrove ecosystem contributes to the biogeochemical cycle and nutrient transformation by various mechanisms. Unveiling the diversity and the structure of microbial communities in mangrove environments is the very first step in understanding their role in the functioning of entire ecosystems. These rhizosphere microorganisms contribute to the productivity of mangroves, and thus they eventually help in maintaining plant health and the overall ecosystem resilience. Details of these cultures. This is another view from a solo project in Delhi of the work residue, which you saw earlier. It's a different kind of interpretation of it. You can see some details from the work. So what you, like, technically, if I'm to explain this work to you, this work is entirely built up in layers. So you have photographic prints which are overlapped with points, which are overlapped with still screens, which are then again overlapped with layer drawings on plexiglass and on acrylic sheets as well. Here you see microscopic images again, this time of mangrove roots, stems, leaf petioles. Some details, I don't know how clear it is, but images from light microscopy. A view from an installation view from a recent show. This work is called Blue Shores of Silence. It's a film. And this is important for me because here, this is some of the ways by which research outcomes for me can come together with poetry and with creative writing in order to convey a message. This is filmed entirely in the swamps of Vedaranyam, and also documents parts of the Indian Ocean, where large sections of the Muthuped mangrove forests have completely submerged after the 2004 tsunami. This work constantly talks about the ode to water and looks at this water systems that we take for granted as both givers and takers of life. I need the sea because it teaches me. The sea is the source of living and the dying. Signs of Skin is a series of short documentaries that looks at various aspects of coastal ecologies. Tied to the fragility of the mangrove ecosystem, is the ecological and livelihood security of coastal communities. Rising sea temperatures and changes in coastal shorelines, along with chronic human misuse of ecosystems, such as overfishing and pollution, are paving the way towards an apocalyptic future. These films explore the traditional skills, indigenous knowledge systems, and fishing techniques used by fisherfolk that are under great threat and at the risk of being replaced by modern, unsustainable technologies that damage ecosystems. According to me, the success of all efforts which are directed at restoring these ecosystems depends largely on recognizing the important role that fishermen, fisherfolk, and indigenous people have. And they can play a very essential role in coping with the environmental damage. In the Muthuped mangrove forests, a 200-year-old traditional method of fishing in the wetlands could actually be the key to restoring vast degraded mangrove belts. In the crowded fish landing center of Anand Kovil, you can see this. Fishermen discuss the possibilities of fish mortality, declining fish catch, and its consequences. In the Pichavram wetlands, a forgotten tribe is already practicing a new way of life, of managing and conserving the biodiverse mangrove forests that are pointing the way forward to a sustainable future. The Salt Lab is an ongoing series of work which has been funded by a grant from the Department of Biotechnology and the Wellcome Trust UK, and in collaboration with Coach International Artists Association in Delhi. And this body of work, which is very much in its initial phases right now, it focuses on the agricultural crisis in India with an emphasis on climate change, salinity, emerging agricultural technologies, including transgenics, food and nutrition security in the country. In this work, I also try to explore various socio-economic impacts of migration in the context of agriculture and climate change in India. Here again, I've worked very closely with leading scientific and research organizations of the country, drawing data and vital information from the fields of transgenic biotechnology, microbiology, and ecotechnology. The artistic investigation speculates about a future where the transgenic has become vital for human survival. So when you walk into this space, you see these images. What you see here is images of over 20 saline tolerant rice cultivars, as well as transgenic tobacco plants in the center, and you have rice on the side. The central images you have in the center, you see images of mangrove genes that have been introduced into tobacco for experiment, and this is all in the process of actually growing transgenic rice. These are formative processes. And on the right side, on the right and left area, you see indigenous saline tolerant rice species from various parts of the country, which include Pokhali, Matla, Kaksal, Nona Bokra, Nola Soren, Ghias, and Rupsal, among other varieties from various coastal regions of India. The work tries to contemplate ideas such as, what is the future of food? What role will transgenic food crops play in addressing climate change challenges in the future? And it also contemplates on the role of humankind as makers, and what are the kind of technologies in the future which will actually shape the future of food in our country. Is the text visible? Okay, so I'll just read one or two from here. When margins are slender, vulnerability to adverse climate is magnified. Sometimes this is a chronic and steady worsening process that encourages migration with its own consequences, or even worse consequences with catastrophic climate events. Food shocks are a part of this. I think there are bigger economic and social problems to consider when one thinks about ownership of seeds. The government has large food security and anti-poverty programs, but there are critical gaps in terms of inclusion and exclusion errors. Women and girls are particularly disadvantaged. Adaptation is a key strategy that alleviates the severity of climate change impacts on agriculture and food production. Adaptation strategies are unlikely to be effective without an understanding of the farmers' perceptions of climate change. A gene from the mangrove species was introduced into a cultivated rice variety called the Pusa Basmati. And then after the usual testing, molecular testing to ensure that the gene had been introduced, it was then tested in limited field trials in the campus within the atomic power plant in Kalpakkam, where it showed tolerance to 150 millimolar of salt and also to a great extent drought tolerance. Another work from this series called Altered Growth, Inner Life of the Transformed. This is a video piece, which is actually an animation. It's an animation of a transgenic tobacco plant growing inside a petri dish. So here you can see the various stages of growth. So each part has been actually photographed meticulously, and then the entire thing has been animated. And this work must have taken about over 100 hours of animation to make. Again, viewers looking at the work, this is at Khoj in Delhi. Another work, this is a part of a three-piece work where you have three short films, each of which show you sections of a stem, a leaf, and a root, and you see the expression of a mangrove gene within a tobacco plant. So the green areas that you're seeing is the expression of the mangrove gene in there. I think we can skip the other work. Now I'll just come to talk about some of the key points here. So what are the possibilities of art-science collaborations? In my opinion, collaboration between the arts and the sciences has the potential to create new knowledge, ideas, and processes that are both valuable and beneficial to both the fields. An art-science collaboration may be important at this crucial time when the world is feeling the impacts of climate variability and change, yet many are still unable to really connect with this problem at hand. Art forms can celebrate scientific accomplishments, create new forms of scientific data, and also offer a platform for critique. The inquiry, the process, and the product, which is the creation itself, these are possibly the three core areas or fields in which both artists and scientists can overlap in collaborative projects. I think the idea of just asking a question through an altered lens is very imperative. While working, I often sense the large gap between the scientific and the cultural worlds. I feel that more often than not, scientific data is inaccessible and absent from our daily culture and the general public. The science community, again, faces the challenging task of communicating and relaying scientific outcomes to policymakers, to stakeholders and other non-scientific communities who can pursue policies and actions based on the information that they provided. Visual arts has the power to spark dialogue, to envision ideas, to make the intangible tangible, to introduce and inject the issues into our mainstream culture. Art practice can often be seen as a form of intellectual and imaginative inquiry, and as a place where research can be carried out that is robust enough to yield reliable insights that are well grounded and also culturally relevant. I think both artists and scientists are qualified and proficient at looking for the unexpected and the unforeseen, and both celebrate what they describe. That is an exclusive and exceptional shared skill each brings to the problem-solving experience. So therefore, we need the languages of both art and science to save us from stockpiling endless information that fails to inform our ignorance or our irresponsibility in these troubled times. The significant question here is, how can artists and scientists then come together in collaboration that will benefit all players, including the public? we find common grounds as we acknowledge the importance of ethically engaging the public in critical yet empowering dialogues and exchanges. When both artists and scientists take a moment to just step back from their disciplinary niches, they can realize and appreciate many approaches to understanding and unfolding our human experience. We are shaped and are shaped and shaped by a caretaking, consumption, manipulation of, destruction of, and compassion for other beings. Human evolution, we must not forget, is a multi-species endeavor. This process of entanglement is more pervasive and broadly distributed in today's era more than ever before. Reflecting on God process in human evolution can give us insight into what we can, will, and should do as members of global yet very local ecologies. We need to look at intertwined processes of becoming. So when my work offers a turning point towards the mangroves, it shows the veins, the details, and the beauty of their liveliness amidst the grief of their death. The works and installations reveal the necessary entwinement and entanglement of humans with our other than human kin. To recognize these world-building capacities offers different models from which to think what environmentalism might mean in the 21st century. Ones where the humans and the mangroves might engage in mutual care for one another. This is what I call the turning toward that involves daily and rhythmic recognition of our inevitable and humbling enmeshment, much like the roots of the mangroves in my work. I think one way to stop seeing trees or rivers or hills as natural resources is to really class them as fellow beings or kinfolk. I guess I'm trying to subjectify the universe, because honestly, look where objectifying it has gotten us. To subjectify is not necessarily to co-opt, to colonize and exploit. Rather, it involves a great reach outward of the mind and of the imagination. Let's look at the simple example of symbiosis and life on Earth. The necessity of working together makes life on Earth possible. But symbiosis is also vulnerable. Corals, let's look at the example of corals. They're tied to other species in rapidly shifting worlds. We all know that coral reefs are made up of animal, plant, and more. And these systems all hang together in very fragile coordination. But any form of disrupted relationships within this system leads to the decline and death. This is the importance of symbiotic making. Symbiotic relations must be restored, renewed, and negotiated within life's entanglements. Symbiosis is vulnerable, and the fate of one species can change entire ecosystem. If the microbial community or biodiversity of the mangroves declines, the entire ecosystem will die, and that has a direct effect on us. This is something that we really need to understand. For we are all connected by common ecologies. This is one of the gravest challenges of our times. Entanglements with others makes life possible, but when one relationship goes bad, the repercussions triple. We are, after all, mixed up with other species. We cannot survive without them. Without our intestinal bacteria, we cannot digest our food. Without endosymbiotic dinoflagellates, the coral polyps will lose their vitality. Yet, we have more often than not been in common denial of all these entanglements. Look at what we do. We grow plantations. We grow monocrops in these plantations and single crops that will deny the intimacies of companion species. Look at our modern dairy and meat farm systems. We raise a handful of supercharged breeds. A new kind of monstrosity will attack us. Our entanglements in such cases are blocked and concealed, and they will return to us as pathogens and they will spread toxins. Industrial toxins will weave their way into our food chains. Nuclear byproducts will sicken us, not just through our human cells, but through the bacteria in our gut. What we need at this time is a cross-disciplinary curiosity about the world that we inhabit. For instance, a curiosity that will open up questions about multi-species mixes that makes up our planet. Important question I think we should all ask ourselves is, who are we? The human microbiota is the aggregate of microorganisms that resides on or within any of a number of human tissues and biofluids. And there are about 10 times as many microbial cells in the human body as there are human cells. So are we really just human? Our continued survival demands that we learn how best to live with the entanglements that we had. And we need to see both sides of these entanglements, entanglements as life and as danger. We should then begin with a simple practice, just a very, very simple practice, which is both humble and difficult, of taking time to really notice the world around us. Thank you.
So if you have other questions, so I was very curious with all the biological images that you have, a lot of microscopy images and plant to culture images. Did you do them yourself, or were these experiments that were done for your project, or these are images that are available with the biologists that you're dealing with?
So that's an important question, and to answer that, the image which you saw with the rice, you know, the salt lab series of work, where I mentioned that there was 20 indigenous species of rice. So this was a project that went up as a proposal to DBT, to sort of where I wanted to really explore indigenous methods of farming and just see how these rice is actually resilient in these places, you know, as opposed to commercial culture of rice. And through conversations with MSSRF, they were able to, they resourced the grains from, you know, some they already had in their banks and some they sourced from other places. And then these were specifically grown in the lab for the project. And this was done over a period of 8 months, where I continuously went back and forth from Delhi to Chennai and documented each one in various stages of growth. Similarly, the project that you saw with the bacterial cultures, I specifically needed a certain kind of culture because we're looking at the visual artists, you know, we're looking at the visual arts, right? So the images I needed also, they had certain specifications, like I needed some of the images is, you know, needed to be evocative in a way that the audience, it can engage the audience in some kind of reaction. So those were cultured and preserved for me, and then they were all documented by me in the UV laminar cabinets at the labs. So essentially most of the work that you see here, of course, again, the on-site visits and all the photography and documentation has been done by me, but along for each of the field trips, I have been accompanied by various people, experts, scientists, environmentalists, as well as local people, like indigenous people, fishermen and other people. So it's really all a collaborative effort.
What was the reaction? So you were showing some
indigenous
races that are
salt-resistant. Correct, like Pukali in Kerala.
There was an attempt by, you know, the modern science to create transgenic rice.
Exactly,
So there, you know, it's the artistic process that has sort of thrown the light on the indigenous culture or given. So what was the reaction that the scientists had when, you know, they came, or did they even know that these...
Of course they knew, you know, like we people who are working with these ecosystems, like if I can talk about MSSRF for instance, I mean, they are in tandem with a lot of the farmers in various parts of the country and other organizations which are also encouraging, you know, cultivating these rice forms as a form of looking at sustainable futures. But what I found is that, I mean, at least for a lot of these organizations, they still feel that there needs to be a balance there. Because, you know, if we're looking and talking about climate change and salinity is a growing demon. It's the reality that we all have to face with. And it's going to degrade agricultural lands. It's already, that process has already begun. And if you go on site, you can actually see the salinated soils, it's not hidden from us. It's all around us. You know, those images are just all around us. But what they feel at that point is that, you know, that we need to have both. That we will need to have transgenic food crops in the future. It's a matter of survival. If you look at survival, then for a lot of people, the debate is that survival comes first. But at the same time, we need more funding, for instance, from the government to be able to grow, to be able to give incentives to the farmers to grow these other kind of crops, right? So there has to be that balance. So for this particular body of work, the Sol Lab, I think my purpose pretty much was not to say or point out as what is right or what was wrong, rather to introduce the audience to all of these concepts. And our audience is intelligent. You know, the viewer is intelligent. The idea is that through the medium, one brings up questions and that sparks a debate and a dialogue. And I think for me, a lot of my practice, that is a relevant part of my practice. You know, if it can spark dialogues and discussions about these things which we don't even really think about or talk about in our daily life. We need to sit back and actually think about things. We are so engaged in our daily routine that we don't even think about wider things, right?
Next, please. You know, in the scientific technology of entanglement, there is a controlling super species. And therefore, would that at all of the same order?
Same
order.
Mm-hmm.
Because it lends itself to the same kind of exploitative positions that technologies of other times have done. And I think that entanglement is really something which is so precious.
Yes,
so
absolutely.
Important that your art should really point out how science is sitting over species rather than entering into collaboration with species. This would be something which would be very, very
thank you for that observation. Thank you very much.
So, we want to thank you, Sonia, for coming.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.